بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
So to go straight to the point, first, thank you for all of the organizers, and I think it's really important to have this kind of conferences and one day conference and within the Islamic Awareness Week to make it to open the floor for debates and a better understanding, especially on terrorism today, is something that we have to tackle and that we have to try to find a way to speak about this very sensitive topic, and at the same time to raise questions about what is going on. So let me start with a short introduction with three main points about the whole thing and the topic, and then to come to an Islamic approach again to contemporary issues that what we are witnessing on the ground. First thing that we have to say when it comes to terrorism is that if you listen to all the international institutions, it may be the European Union, the European Council, the United Nations, if you try to get a very precise definition of what terrorism is all about, you will not get it. Because the states, because the specific institution, they don't agree on the very meaning of what terrorism is all about. There is no international agreed definition. And it means that there is something that we have to take into account when it comes sometimes to not only what groups are doing, but what states are doing. Because here we have a disagreement on when starts the reality of terrorism, when innocent people are killed. And what we have as something that we, by and large, we agree is that is to kill innocent people while we are not in a state of war. While we are not in a state of war. So it's really something which has to do with it. This is why we speak about terrorism when you, for example, as in September 11th, you have people who are going to kill innocent people. There is no state of war. There is nothing. And then innocent people are targeted per se, and we know, and the people who are indulging in this know that they are targeting innocent people, and this is exactly what they want. So there is something here which is a broad definition. Now, when it's in time of war, what we have heard these last years is that in times of war, when you are killing innocent people, these are collateral damages. So it's not terrorism, it's collateral damages. You are killing innocent people, and because the time of war helps you not to speak about terrorism or state terrorism. It happened, of course, in Palestine. We heard this first time the term in Palestine, in Iraq, and recently during the last summer in Lebanon, where we were listening to. Because it's the state of war, killing innocent people is not terrorism, is collateral damages. These people are victims of something which is beyond them, the state of war. And I think that we have to come to this also understanding, because the victims, they don't see it at all like this. They are speaking about plain terrorism when even if it's in time of war, the enemies are just knowing that they are killing innocent people, and they know that, and they are aware of what they are doing. So this is something which is a very important point when it comes to terrorism. We have to sit and to ask ourselves why there is no common definition, in which way, and why we are accepting sometimes that innocent people can be killed in time of war without using the term terrorism, and not condemning the same way we are condemning all kinds of terrorism. I think that this is a very important point. Second point, which is really important, many Muslims, they don't agree with the fact that we are speaking about Islamic terrorism. And I think that this is something which is really important. To qualify terrorism as something which is Islamic is problematic. We don't do that really when it comes to other religions. The point is that we may disagree with this formula and this way of speaking, and I think that we have to show reservation in the way we are speaking about this. But now what we have to acknowledge as a fact that that they are Muslims now involved in acts considered as terrorists. So we cannot avoid the question in which way their teachings, the way they are saying that they are relying on the Islamic teachings and connecting this to such activities and such acts, we have to ask ourselves from within the Muslim community, from, you know, among the Muslim scholars, in which way we have to tackle the issue and to come with a clear response. Is this acceptable in Islamic terms? Even though we don't agree with something which is Islamic terrorist, because they are two mutually exclusive concepts, we don't accept this, but still we know that some Muslims are involved. So we need to answer from an Islamic viewpoint about this, to this question. And I think this needs a very strong answer. Now, there is something, and this is the third point, which is really important. As I said, we have a problem of definition, and we also have to put things into context. And there is something which is really important when it comes to terrorists today. And I want it to be clear. We have to put things into context and to try to understand. But when I'm saying to try to understand, you know, when I was in the States just after September 11th, and I was once talking to someone, so okay, I want to understand what is happening. And when it comes also to the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, you say, I want to understand. For some people, to try to understand is to justify. I want it to be very clear. To try to understand why people are doing what they are doing, it doesn't mean that you can justify what they are doing. And this is something which is essential, to try to understand the context. Why people in a specific context are doing what they are doing, it doesn't mean that you agree with what they are doing. You try just to understand. So it's essential in our discussion not to accept these passionate debates, be against or with. It's not to be against or with, it's to try to understand and then you take a stand. I'm against or I'm with. But you have to take a stand to understand why. Because when, for example, Sharon said just after September 11th, we also have our terrorist, and our terrorist is Yasser Arafat. He was putting on the same level, exactly at the same level, the Palestinian resistance to what happened in the States. And any analyst or political expert cannot accept this, that the Palestinian resistance, you know, even if we can disagree with some means they are using, it's not at all the same as people going to the States and killing people or innocent people. If you put everything on the same, say, okay, because they are all terrorists, we don't ask about the context, we condemn everything without referring to the context, without explaining, so it's just condemnation. Because if you try to explain, it means that you are going towards justification. This is a simplistic response and understanding, and more than that, there is an ideology behind this, which is to say, as long as we are able to put the label terrorist, no explanation, no contextualization, condemnation is enough. And I think it's not going to work like that. It cannot work like that. We cannot accept. And we cannot put Yasser Arafat and all the Palestinian resistance at the same level of what, you know, Ayman al-Zawahiri or Bin Laden are saying when it comes to you can kill an American because he or she is an American without any other explanation. It's not a time of war, but they are guilty by assimilation to their identity as American. I think that this is not at all the same. So we need to contextualize and we need to understand. Having said that, very often the people are saying, you know, if you try to understand, you are justifying. And I'm always taking an example. It happened to me. I liked so much one of my students when I was teaching 20 years ago. I was teaching at secondary school. And I was teaching to one kid who was very bright, very interesting, but totally marginalized. And he had personal problems. I liked him. And at one time, I got a call from his sister telling me, come, my brother beat my mother. I came to the hospital and said, it's not acceptable. I was just, you know, disappointed. I was to do something against him, to come and to shout at him. So how could you do that? At the point that I was coming there just to do this, I was going to him and to tell him this is not acceptable and to shout at him and to show how angry I was. His teacher took me on the side and told me, look, this was what was happening in our home. My father used to beat my mother in front of us. Violence was our, you know, natural way of speaking. And then I understood. I understood what was happening. I would never justify what he was doing, but I understood where it was coming from. So understanding is not justifying. I would never justify someone beating his mother, but I can understand from where it comes. So I need to take another stand and to understand it in a specific context. So this is intellectual empathy and understanding, not going to so as far as to justify something. I think it's really important to come to this understanding when we talk about this. One thing that I wanted to say then is really to come from an Islamic viewpoint in which we are dealing with terrorists and why we should have a very strong position on this and a very clear one. First, once again, we have a central concept in Islam which is jihad, and it's used in different ways. As Suyuti in his work was speaking about 80 occurrences dealing with jihad, definition, implementation, or definition, understanding, and implementation. It's a very wide concept to be used in different situations, in different understanding at a different level of our spiritual, personal, social, political, and sometimes in conflict reality. The point here is that, in fact, very often we speak about jihad as if we were dealing with struggles and the way to tackle struggles. In fact, the very meaning of jihad is the way towards peace. Jihad is a concept leading us towards peace, because at the end, what is the highest objective of the Islamic teaching is peace. And when in the concept of Islam there is salam meaning peace, and there is not, you know, we are very often translating Islam by submission. It's not only this, it's not the way we are, you know, submission could have a very negative, you know, connotation. It's much more to enter God's peace, enter into God's peace with all your heart. The point is that we need to get to that peace, but peace has conditions. And it's always like this. To get peace, you have to resolve some of the tensions you have. First, inner peace is to resolve the inner tensions that you have between your bad temptation and your good dimension, your good temptation, your good aspirations. And here, this struggle, the natural state is not to be at peace with our own self, is to be in tension. So what we are trying to do is to resist the bad temptations with all what we have as the good dimension, the good characteristic and the good features of our inner self. So it's to resolve the natural tension to get a spiritual peace. This is jihad, from struggle to peace. It's exactly the same. So in fact, the very meaning is to resist the bad temptations by promoting the good dimension of ourself. It's exactly the same when it comes to collective reality, when you have people who are oppressing, repressing, who are dictators, who are not respecting the human dignity. What you are doing is to resist the oppression, not only for this our struggle, but to go beyond these tensions to get a just peace between you and them. So the point here of jihad is really something which is a way towards peace by resisting oppression or resisting bad temptation. The meaning of jihad is this. So it's exactly the opposite of what we have in the media. Very often when we speak about jihad, it's presented as the way towards war. No, it's the way towards peace, but peace has conditions. And the first is really education, self-education when it comes to myself. When it comes to our living together, is to respect each other, to be able, and it doesn't come like this. No one here in this room is born or was born as a Democrat from the very beginning. We learn to listen to people, we learn to respect the other, because when we are kids, the problem is that very often we are selfish and the ego is central. We need to decenter ourselves from your own ego out of a spiritual or intellectual or social education. And jihad is all about this. And at the beginning, the first appearance of the concept of jihad is really about something which has nothing to do with qital, with war. It has to do with something which is resist to the intellectual and social oppression. لا تطيع الكافرين. So don't obey to the people who are denying the truth of your message. وجاهدهم به جهادا كبيرا. And strive against them with what? With the Quran. So your weapon is the Quran, is an intellectual means. You are resisting their oppression with an intellectual a message. Your message is your weapon. Your message is that what you are presenting to them. You want to kill me? Here is the book. به all the مفسرين here in Quran, the revealed message. So this was the first thing, and then when they went to Medina after 13 years in Mecca, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بِأَنَّهُمْ ظُلِمُوا, there is a message here that they want to destroy you. You can resist their oppression by with the same means that they are using, but only against their oppression you can resist the oppressor. And this is something which is essential, is and it's coming out of all the teaching. I don't have time now, in half an hour it's a bit difficult, but all the teachings that we have coming from this is building something which is an ethics of war. So when they want to destroy you, when they want to kill you, you can resist with the means that they are using only against the oppressors at the level they are using. So it's something which is a legitimate resistance to their oppression against the oppressors, and only against the oppressors. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, was dealing with situation of war, he had sometimes to come to a very strong statement where, for example, Khalid ibn al-Walid killed prisoners. He said, I'm innocent from what you were doing. When he killed a woman, say to Khalid ibn al-Walid that the Prophet has prohibited killing children, women, and slaves. So they have nothing to do with this state of war. You cannot touch innocent people. And then this was all the traditions that we have. And what we have is just when the Prophet, peace be upon him, sent Usama just before he passed away, he started to give him some of the element of this ethic of war. And who repeated this in the hadith which is that we have afterward is Abu Bakr Siddiq. And Abu Bakr Siddiq was putting some of the conditions in a situation of war. You will not kill the children, the religious people, the women, the old people, and don't touch the trees and the fruit trees. Don't touch the nature. Don't touch the creation. Setting here what we have as the ethics of war. So when you are facing the enemy, only the people who are facing you, armed people who want to kill you, you have the right to resist them. But anyone else, no one else you can touch, and no woman, so nothing about, you know, the innocent people. You cannot just do that. And even the nature, the creation, and we have two or three stories, very interesting, coming from the Prophet tradition, the Prophet's Sira, which means his life, his biography, where he was so cautious not to hurt the animals, not to hurt anything dealing with nature. He was so respectful towards everything which was around him in this respect. So the point for us is really to understand that in one occurrence, we have a jihad dealing with fatal in very specific situation where you are oppressed, a legitimate resistance to the oppressed, against the oppressors, and only against the oppressors. These are the legitimate means that you can use. Once again, it's a very broad and quick presentation, but what I wanted to do out of this, in our discussion here, is to come to this ethics of war. It's just telling us something which is really important. Ethically speaking, as we are speaking as Muslims, anything which has to do with killing innocent people who have nothing to do, even in a state of war, meaning by that there is nothing like an accepted, you know, concept of collateral damage. We don't have this kind of thing. And this is why, from the very beginning, I don't only have a problem with, you know, the nuclear weapon, possessed by one or the other country. the nuclear weapon as such is problematic because as such it means we are going to kill innocent people. So per se, that this weapon is problematic. So on the ethical ground, it's not only to say, okay, look, it's a question for about Iran possessing the nuclear weapon. What about Israel? What about the United States of America? What about all the other countries who are having this weapon and they can use it, and we know, and we knew that it happened. Who used it in history? Not so far ago. Not long time ago. And they killed innocent people. These are collateral damages or something which is a kind of potential and real state terrorists, because we knew that by using these we were to kill innocent people. So the point here is really the deep discussion on the ethical ground, and we need this discussion. And having said that, all the people who know that they are going out of their behavior and action to kill innocent people are acting against the ethics, the Islamic ethics on that. And we have to be clear on that. So these means are not acceptable. It's not justifiable, Islamically speaking, on the ethical ground. And I think we have to be clear on that. Now let me conclude with what we can say about our file. When it comes to what happened in the States, and very often we speak about, you know, it's quite interesting, our perception of reality. We speak about what happened in New York, September 11th, we speak about what happened in this country. On July the 7th, we speak about what happened in Madrid, but don't forget that it happened in Bali, an Islamic country, it happened in Jordan, it happened in Egypt. So don't just speak about terrorists, which were, you know, the victims were perceived as us, Westerners. Many victims were Muslims in Islamic country. And all this, for me, the statement should be clear, it's to be condemned with no reservation, a clear condemnation. This is not, as I say, not only non-Islamic, it's anti-Islamic. It's against the Islamic, you know, values. And all the people who are understanding this in and try to say, okay, because we have, and then we have to argue the political ground. When, for example, I was in Burkina Faso, and I was saying killing innocent people in a time of war is not acceptable as a Muslim, and much, and moreover, when we are not in a state of war. And some Christian Burkinabe, coming from Burkina Faso, came to me and told me, look, can I ask you a question? When every day in our world, on our continent, 100,000 people are killed because of this economic order, is it not a state of war? Is it not an order which is a terrorist economic order? Then you have to enter the discussion. I disagree with him. You cannot speak about it. You cannot just play with the words. It's not the same. But what he's saying is that aware, mind, be aware that this order is an unjust order, and then you also have to say no to terrorists, but also to all the causes of injustices in our world. So we also have to listen to this, not to accept the conclusion, not to accept the way the equation is put, but at least to listen to some of the understanding. And by the way, he was not a Muslim, he was a Burkinabe, one of the poorest country in the world, asking the West, you are sitting there speaking about democracy, justice, not killing innocent people, but we are innocent and we are killed every day out of this order, which is an unjust economic order. Think about it. It may be also another perception. So here I still have 3 minutes to conclude. I wanted to say something about this condemnation is clear. Now, I will never accept someone telling me, okay, what happened in New York and all this, it's exactly the same as what is happening now in Iraq and Palestine. And I want to be clear on this. The condemnation of killing innocent people in Palestine or in Israel or in Iraq is clear. The means for me are ethically unjustifiable. Islamically speaking, you cannot say it's Islamically possible to kill innocent people. That's clear. Now what I want the people to do is to come to the context and to say, please, when you have a regional hyperpower not respecting the Palestinian rights, And the whole world, not only the West, but also the so-called Islamic Arab countries who are betraying it. But the problem of, you know, many Muslims are saying our problems, the cause of all our problems is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. My answer is no, it's not the cause, it's the consequence. We have much more, much deep crisis beyond the problem. The problem is just revealing how much we are divided, no unity, no principles. We blame the West, but the problem, the disease is in the Islamic world itself and among the Arab countries. And who is betraying more today the Palestinians is not the United States of America. It's the Islamic, so-called Islamic countries, the Arab countries, the so-called Islamic world. They have betrayed the Palestinians. So this is to be clear that I'm not blaming the West. But what I want to say is that when all the world is silent, and not just looking at the reality of Palestinians deprived from their rights for more than 60 years now, and having on the at the United Nations level 64 resolutions not respected by the country, and then when it comes to kill one member of Hamas, you are ready to destroy a building with more than 30 innocent people in the house. What is this? Collateral damages? I'm sorry, it's pure, for me, this is my definition, state terrorism. You know that you are going to kill innocent people. So when I would say, look, the fact that Palestinians are killing innocent people, this is not justifiable. But what I can say, it's explainable. And by saying it's explainable, I'm not. I'm saying I try to understand why. And my point to the international community is not to be silent, to say, look, we have to condemn and sit down. This kind of elitist, you know, stand, I cannot accept this. Because we are dealing with people who are being, you know, dealing with killing, no dignity at all. I'm sorry, all the people I know who went to Palestine, who went to the what we call the occupied territories, but they are devastated territories, in fact. All the people are saying they are facing arrogance, they are facing undignified way of being treated. They are not treated as human beings. So the point here is that I can understand that someone is saying, what do I have to lose? What is the point? You are not, no one is speaking on our behalf. So the point is asking, yes, let us condemn every single act against innocent people, but let us condemn the silence of the international community, because our silence is as condemnable as their violence. And our violence is nurturing this. So the point for me, I will never put everything on the same level. I really think that we have to be very, very precise in the way we define things, and very, very respectful towards people who are just now deprived from their rights and have been deprived from their rights for more than two generations.
I'm Ali Al-Darba, the spokesman for the Iraqi government. We are delighted, Mr. Tarek, the other colleagues, that we are here. We traveled such a long distance to come to participate with you in one-day discussion, which is very important. We feel that it is an important day. And for the country, which you know what we are facing there. And it is a very important issue for all Muslims, which we are facing now, a real challenge, to define where we are with stand for such massive killing, for a brain destruction of young generation, for the heritage for others, and the sectarian feeling. All such things are nothing to do with Islam. Islam is a religion of peace. Religion of mercy. It's a moderate religion. In order to be moderate, we should understand that we don't own full truth in this life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give the authority to anyone to implement by force the Islam. Implementing Islam by force is hijacking Islam. Whether it is wilayat al-faqih, whether it is a Khalifa, whether it is Islamic Emirate, which what we are facing now in Iraq. There is no mandatory religious formula to rule the people. Unless Muslims criticize and investigate their history to eliminate the killing mistakes which accompanied the way which been ruling after the fourth Khalif and putting forward all the great values of Islam, to isolate this portion of Muslims which try to destroy Islam, to destroy Muslims, as well as a humanitarian moderate values of the others. This is the questions which we have to answer all. This is a real challenge for all Muslims to present the real Islam. Islam is being understood now as a religion of terrorism, because the whole ideology, wherever in the Muslim world, what we are facing in Iraq, people are killing each other in the name of the religion, whether they are Shia or Sunnis. They are misusing the religion in their ideology, in their theology. The most important is the education. The education in the Muslim world, this is an important role which you, as a scholar, and the others who are educating the Muslims in the Muslim world, they have to understand that we are part of this world. We are part of a community, a world community, which we have to participate in this. We cannot isolate ourselves. We cannot keep ourselves isolated from the others because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't ask us to do so. Thank you very much.
Yes, I think that you can understand that out of what I was saying, I agree with you that what we have to do is really to have a better understanding. It's a question of education. Once again, it's really important to promote this understanding, and this is why such conferences and other talks and other involvement within the Muslim communities, not only here in the West, but in the Islamic majority countries, is so important. We have to do that. We have to deepen our understanding of the Islamic teachings, that true. But whatever will be this process, whoever is trying to do it, and whatever it can be very, you know, it can be very deep, and at the end, we also have to understand that we are dealing with political issues. So we have, yes, to condemn, you know, terrorists, we condemn this understanding that Muslims can kill, you know, once again, innocent people or kill each other. But we also have to add to this condemnation political understanding of what is going on. Iraq is a very complex issue. Yes, we have to condemn what is going on now. But the overall picture is to ask ourselves, who supported the dictator before? Who went to this country and did what was done now? Why this is happening, and in which way? Who is also getting interest from what is going on at the local level in the geostrategic region? I think that we cannot be simplistic only by condemning and not coming to the political ground and try to understand what is going on. Exactly with the Islamic, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. We need a very strong understanding what are the causes, what is going on. While I am speaking now, the Palestinians are now asked, the only question is recognize Israel. Okay, that's fine, but this is also a pretext to something which is happening while I'm talking to you now. Colonization of the occupied territory is continuing, and it had doubled and tripled during the last 3 years. We also have to understand that we have to condemn, it's clear, we have to say Islam is not this, and we need a very deep understanding of Islam. But we cannot also have and not nurture something which is a more complex understanding of the political issues. Iraq is central for the future of the region. Iraq is central. But what we are listening now, you know, if you would have asked me about Iran 3 months ago, I would have told you it's impossible that something happened there. You know what? You know what is happening now? I'm not sure. That with this current American administration, anything could happen. And I think that, yes, we have to condemn, but we also have to have a very deep understanding of a very complex area, a very complex region, where condemnation is not enough. Very deep information, very deep understanding is needed in order to have something which is not only to have an Islamic answer, but a dignified right answer as to which kind of justice we can get and democracies we can get in the region, if this is what we want. Which kind of democracies? An exported democracy from the states is not going to work. An indigenous, built from within, you know, autonomous democracy, built by the people themselves, with their value, their collective psychology, and their culture, this is what is needed. It's not going that way today, and we have to be critical towards this.
Thank you, Professor. I think you wanted to ask something? Can you stand up, please, and shout?
I just want to know that Islamic views on creating conditions for prevention of killing of innocent people. Does Islam favor those creation of those conditions? And that if that is true, then your principle about, you know, creating nuclear weapons which can actually prevent killing of innocent people, how do you understand that?
Yes, that's a very important question, because, you know, we cannot just speak about the weapon per se without understanding the whole geostrategic reality and the, you know, the balance of power. That's totally true. And I think that in that field, we need something which has to come from within the Muslim, not only the Islamic majority countries, but also from the Muslim community, thinking about conflict, peace resolution. And this is, by the way, what I was trying to go to the States to do that. But no way. I'm here with you. No way to go to think about, you know, conflict, religion, and peace building. But this is a very important point in which we can come back to the Islamic ethics and try to build something which is a better understanding in our contemporary world, about a better understanding of the Islamic ethics, a better understanding of the you know, the balanced powers and in which we can deal with this to promote something which is an Islamic understanding towards peace and towards, you know, a real ethics of war. I really think, and conflict resolution coming from the Islamic ethics. We need that, we need this understanding. But once again, deep understanding of Islam, but very deep understanding of the geostrategic and political realities. I don't think that we can just, you know, very often we are pushed as Muslims, okay, tell us the answer as a Muslim from an Islamic people. And we have some scholars speaking very far from the reality. And that's good to speak about this and say, okay, these are the Islamic principles. I'm sorry, we are dealing with lives, we are dealing with human beings, we are dealing with people who are killed. So to sit here and to speak about, you know, a very broad philosophical Islamic understanding with no connection with the Quran is not helping the Islamic understanding, because Muslims are telling you, okay, stop dreaming, we are being killed, so what? But I think that we need to be on that level.
I'll have just two more questions. Would you like to get up, please?
Professor. Mr. Ramadan, you spoke about the ambiguity over the definition of terrorism and what a terrorist is and what terrorism stands for. Earlier on this week, I was reading one of your essays on Sharia law, and you spoke about that revelation calls upon human intellect to determine categories, methodologies, and rule for reading and deduction. So, in order for us as Muslims to lessen the risk of this whole idea of terrorism and terrorist activity becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy, is it not essential and incumbent upon us as Muslims and yourselves as scholars to perhaps go out there and develop this definition and develop a counter-definition of us not being in accordance to terrorism?
Yes, I think that within your question there is already the answer, and I totally agree with this, that this is the work we are doing. It's not in English, but it's in French. I wrote a very short piece about Islam, jihad, war, and peace, trying to come to some of the definitions and to understand which could be our understanding of the essential Islamic concepts and dealing with contemporary issues, and in which we have to connect this. But we have to go further than that. It's really necessary today to get something which is a terminology faithful to the Islamic principles, meaning our tradition, but adapted to the contemporary reality in helping us to have this, you know, balanced understanding of the concept and use of the concept. We are missing this. And by the way, it's a very important point today. Why? Because very often we are dealing with concepts that we perceive are not ours. You know, it's the dominant culture, and some of the Muslims are avoiding the discussion. They go, oh, this is once again a Western way of speaking.
And I think we cannot accept that. We cannot accept that because the question is not coming from our own universe of references, we avoid the deep question which is here. So when some people are saying, there is no Islamic terrorism, so drop the Islamic, and we, okay, terrorism is something that has nothing to do with us. I think, no, we cannot do that, because you have Muslims, as I said, indulging in this kind of activity. So we need an answer, and we need to come to this understanding. So what you are saying on the theoretical level is something which is unavoidable. This is something that we have to do. We are starting. Some people are working on this. And I think that, once again, it's always like this. I don't want to come to this understanding only by a theoretical, far from reality approach. We really need to have this connection between concepts, contemporary world, and specific issues and realities, because the words are, you know, are taking the color of the historical realities. You know, the terrorists of today were very often the liberators of yesterday. Mm-hmm. Look at the people in, just look at in Afghanistan. What the Americans were saying about Massoud, you know, 10 years ago, and he became just an idol 10 years later. Helping them in their strategy. Yesterday a terrorist, and today an icon. What's that? We are not playing with lives. He was killed and assassinated, and we still don't know by whom. And maybe by people who are the allies of the American government. And it may be very, very disappointing just to know that they can play with people when they are killed. So it's not acceptable. We need something very deep.
One last question. Dr. Ramadan, I'd like to ask a question about what you just said, about the indigenous democracy. From my understanding of Islamic history is that this tradition, the democracy that as we understand, hasn't taken root in the last 1300 years after the fall of Khulafa. So what indigenous democracy are we talking about? Because after the 200-year colonial rule, what we've seen is that there is 10 pot dictators, monarchs, absolute monarchs, and the scholars that you talk about have justified their existence in Islam year, decade after decade after decade. So what democracy and indigenous democracy are you talking about? And is it not the only way at this particular moment that it is exported and imposed from somewhere? Is it? That's a question.
You know, when it comes to this question, and we are dealing with history, I think it's important not to generalize, to say it was always like this, and they only had dictators and the scholars. No, look, you can't do that. Many Muslim scholars were really resisting, and they were put in jail because they were resisting these systems. Up to now, you have scholars, very, very respectful scholars, who are still in jail because they are resisting. And not only in the countries we know or we speak about. You know, in Tunisia today, you have people, Muslim scholars, promoting democracy, they are in jail. Because Ben Ali is not a Democrat. But in Saudi Arabia, it's the same. In Egypt, it's the same. In all the majority Islamic countries, we have people who are trying to have another understanding. So the point is that we cannot generalize and say, okay, they were all supporting this. In the Islamic majority countries today, we have tensions, we have people resisting oppressions, and they are being killed and tortured, and sometimes taken from Europe and sent to these jails to be tortured while the European governments were and still are silent. So this is something which is the point. Now let us come to the Islamic majority countries. When we speak about, you know, when I was speaking about democratization, the point for me, it's essential, is to say, okay, look, I am not going to waste my time speaking, you know, all this old debate that we had among Muslim scholars. No, we don't speak about democracy, we speak about Shura, and, you know, we had an Algerian leader who was just in between, you know, between democracy and Shura, and said, okay, let us be agree on this, we will call it Shuracracy. Just to make all the people being on agreement on this. I think that this is not the point. The point is, what are the principles as to the organization of a community are we promoting that are faithful to the Islamic principles? I think that we need to come back to this and to ask ourselves. And if it comes to the five main principles that we can bring to the fore, the first one is the rule of law. We have no problem with a society based on rule of law because the first Islamic science is really law and the way we are contracted. One. Second, equal citizenship. Third, universal suffrage, which is a majority process when it comes to decision. Fourth, accountability. When you are elected, you are accountable towards the people who are electing you. And fifth, separation of power, which was something which was a tradition in this. Like many Muslim scholars, they didn't want to be involved with the government to play a resisting force. So these five principles that we can promote as Muslims, okay, we don't have a problem with this. These are the principles helping us to get something which is a democratization process. This is what we need. Now the problem is that we are dealing with a deep crisis. Yes, we are dealing with dictators. Yes, we are dealing with, you know, government that are not listening to their society. And we have also a problem with our intellectuals, with our scholars, and with not all, once again, and with our what we call civil society. Because we don't see something which is coming, which is drawing a movement helping us to get these five principles and to be faithful to these principles. But I think that the only way for us in the future to get this democratic process or democratization is to be able to say, look, these principles are not against the Islamic, quite the contrary. They are nurtured by the Islamic teachings, and you need in the Islamic majority country to get your model. And the point for me is this, the principles are universal and the models are historical. What we need now is to find a model. You cannot export the American model of democracy in any country. You cannot do that. And in fact, when you look at the European countries, you have all democratic societies. They are all democratic societies with the same five principles. They don't have a problem with the principles, but they have different models. When you go in Britain, they speak about their model, they are laughing at the French one. And we all were laughing at the American one just after the election when Gore was just not knowing if he was the president or not for more than 2 months. We were laughing, say, what's that? They were counting. And it was a very strange system for us. The point here is that we have different models. The future in the Islamic majority countries is to come back to the principles. To be strict on this, no compromise on these principles, and to try to promote something which is a model for each society coming from its culture, its collective psychology, its references, and to let the people find their model, not to impose it onto it, but also to be consistent. When you are asking the population to vote, and they are voting in one way, it's not for you to come and to say, no, you are wrong. We know the right solution. An election which is transparent is the people to vote. It's not for Washington to decide which is the good way to vote. If this is the case, it's not going to work. So it could be wrong, it could be a mistake, it will take time within the society, but we have to promote this. And the last point about this question is, look, don't confuse the Islamic majority societies with the Middle East and the Arab countries. Because you have Senegal, you have Turkey, you have Indonesia, and there are things that are very interesting that we have to study this because there are maybe, you know, intentions with some of the Islamic principles, but they are living with something which is a democratization process, and we don't have to just essentialize the Islamic experience to what is going on in some of the Arab countries. They are not representing the Islamic experiences in the world today. Thank you.
You've talked about understanding and justification. I'm very aware that we had three decades in the last century where we had terrorism created by Christianity and based on Christianity, with the Irish situation that we had, and two different parts of the Christian religion allegedly fighting each other. I'm not sure how much Christianity was involved, but they were certainly affecting innocent people as much as they were affecting each other. But one thing they were not doing, which apparently some people find justification in the Quran, and this is the nub of my question, is the suicide aspect of creating a bomb and mayhem, the so-called suicide bombers. And I'm merely asking you, where do people find within the Quran, and is it your interpretation, that there is a justification in suicide bombing as opposed to individual attacks such as we became used to, with the person creating the attack getting away with it?
Yes, look, it's not the easiest question at the end, but it's an important one. And first, if you look at the overall picture, this question of suicide bombings and the soldier knows that he's going to be killed, but what he's doing as a suicide, knowing that at the end he's going to be killed, is not specific to Islam. We had it in even during the Second World War, many stories about people knowing that at the end they were going to be killed. And if you read, for example, the whole story of Les Justes, Albert Camus is just speaking about this. This was written in the 50s from within the communist tradition, saying that they knew that they were going to be killed. It was an act of suicide. So it's not specifically Islam. Now, is there something that we can find in the Islamic tradition, not specifically in the Quran? We have something, of course, which is many traditions, and one specific where someone was saying to the Prophet, if I go to fight and kill, what will be my future? And he promised the paradise. So he went knowing that entry meant I'm going to be killed. So in fact, if you put this into the context, you understand that it's a kind of, I'm giving my life to fight, but I know that I'm going to be killed. It's something which could just have, the mindset is exactly the same. In fact, I know that there is no way that, so I'm giving my life in the name. In South Africa, in South America, people coming from this situation of war, and the way they are speaking from within, is just give you, it gives you an other picture. So theoretical discussion on this are not always good, because you are on an ethical ground, you need to come to realities, as I said, and it's very important. So my Islamic answer is connected to a human understanding, and this is something that as a Christian, not knowing too much about the Islamic, as you said, teachings, it's really important to keep in mind, because it helps us to get this mutual understanding.